So first, let me thank Delhi University and Devdatta for inviting me to give this talk. I should tell you, by the way, that I'm not an expert in this business. Well, 10 years ago, I knew nothing about it. I used to write op-eds criticizing it without knowing anything about it. That is a requirement for op-eds. But subsequently, I've learned some things desperately paddling under the water because people expected me to know the facts and I didn't. So I picked up things in the last 5, 6 years, 10 years, fairly short period. So that's the extent of my expertise. But it seems to be it's all I have to give, so I'll give that. Now, I'll talk a little bit about the global situation and give you a history of it for people who have not been following nuclear energy, been on for 60 years. Little history, the current status internationally. Then I'll take up the Indian case in that context. I think that will be more useful for you. So this history of nuclear energy has had its ups and downs. There were periods of great enthusiasm, periods of despair, back to again some enthusiasm. So it's had a roller coaster history. And in recent years, the last phase, there was a fresh round of interest followed by a fresh round of controversy, fairly severe, the last 5 years. I'll talk about that. In India also, it's become a very important and widely debated science and technology issue. So both globally and nationally, they've become quite topical discussions on this. Let me start with the global level. When nuclear energy dawned, sort of in the late 40s, it seemed to be the solution to all of mankind's energy needs. And people used to show little cubes of uranium, saying this can light up the entire New York City and so forth and so on. So everybody was very enthusiastic about it at that time. And the US started building nuclear reactors rapidly. And then Europe and the Soviet Union also followed suit. India also started its program fairly early, already in the late 40s, thanks to Baba's interest in the matter and Baba's proximity to Panditji. Other developing countries were slower off the block, but they were encouraged to go nuclear by Eisenhower, who had an Atoms for Peace program, which supported the development of nuclear energy by any developing country that wanted to do it. But all this enthusiasm was replaced after a while by skepticism and opposition, which began to slowly develop in many countries. And what were the contributing factors to this skepticism and opposition? First were these accidents. So there were two major accidents. Minor accidents happen in any industry, but there were two major accidents. One was the Three Mile Island accident in the US, and the other was Chernobyl. And I'll come to Fukushima later. I'm talking about the scenario before that. The second was just greater environmental consciousness. Place like Terry didn't exist in those days. All these are relatively newer trends in public perception. So, and the green parties in Europe, that's a relatively new trend. These things in the began to develop in the 80s, and they felt that nuclear reactors were not safe, they were not environmentally sound. So that contributed to the opposition. And people also began to be aware of the complexity of closing down a reactor once it's finished. In the early stages, nobody worried about that. The difficulty was in constructing it, making it run and learning how to run it. Once you ran it for 10 or 20 years, you said, now what am I going to do when I have to turn this off eventually? So as you can imagine, decommissioning, which basically means, you know, closing it down, and disposing of the spent fuel from the reactors, which are all highly radioactive things. These issues came up, understandably, a couple of decades later, and people began to realize how complex and expensive that is going to be. So all these three factors and some other ones contributed to the opposition that began to develop once some 20, 30 years had elapsed after the initial enthusiasm. Now, some countries like France, Russia, China, and India continued with their programs. When this skepticism started, they didn't slow down things. India's case, I'll talk about in greater detail. But other countries like the US really stopped. So after the Three Mile Island, public pressure resulted in the US stopping licensing of all new reactors. Of course, they had 100 reactors by then, and 100 were working. They didn't stop a reactor from working, but they stopped building more. So after building about 100 reactors by the 1970s, further growth was frozen, and it remained frozen for several decades. Germany also stopped increasing nuclear capacity. This is even before Fukushima. Now Germany has completely closed it down. But much earlier, because of the pressure of green parties, they stopped increasing the capacity. Just like the US also stopped increasing its capacity. Some countries like Norway and Italy simply had no nuclear reactors at all. In the case of Italy, particularly surprising, because the man who's their national hero was the man who invented reactors for me. So this sort of little histogram just illustrates what I said. So from 1995 onwards, there was a rapid growth, and then growth became less rapid, and after about 1990, it just slowed down. And some of this growth was actually planned earlier. It takes about 10 years typically from planning the reactor, getting the license to delivering power. So you can imagine that this flattening actually started much earlier. And any event afterwards, for the next 15 years, you can see this is flat. And I don't have a graph which goes later, but it's more or less flat even now. So this sort of shows you the trend of nuclear power expansion. These things are the installed capacity in terms of gigawatts. The other numbers are the number of reactors. They're roughly 1:1. So this is the way the global trend has gone. Then it remained, as I said, flat. Then just a few years ago, there was a revival again. And that revival was prompted by concern over climate change. So people began to worry more about carbon emission by coal and hydrocarbons. And in the light of that, the reactor seemed like a lesser evil. So very many environmental groups, which were opposed to reactors before, began to support it as the lesser of the two evils. Not all, but many. So there was a revival around the world saying maybe we have to go nuclear. And particularly when countries were made to cut down their carbon emissions. The other reason why there was a revival was that there were improved safety features. As any new technology, in the beginning there are bugs and there are things that break down, but gradually they improve them. And also when the reactors started in the world, the first time in mankind, so to speak, these nuclear things were being done, so people didn't know what will happen when. But after two more decades of reactor use, there were no major accidents, except for Three Mile Island at that time, even if you take two. So compared to what you might have feared in the first year or second year, statistically it became safer. That's distinct from technologically becoming safer. It's just the number of reactor hours in the denominator, number of accidents in the numerator. The denominator had grown considerably by then. So with all this, there was a revival, and as usual, the revival had to be done by the US. The US government, in the sort of Bush years, late Bush years, had a nuclear power program and an Energy Policy Act that was initiated to encourage American reactor builders. In America, as you know, all reactors are built by private utility companies, unlike India, where it's built by government. So they supported them with loans and so on. So about 20 more applications have been received since then of 34 new plants in the US just in the last few years. These are all applications, they are still being considered. None of them has been granted yet, but that takes years. So this is a big reversal back in the forward direction. And other countries also began to express interest in starting civilian nuclear programs. Once the US started and the mood changed around the world, other countries also wanted to start again. So I'll show you this thing. This is by a friend of mine. There are equivalent graphs. Many of you might yourself have worked on these things. This is a way of just a typical illustration of how the nuclear can help carbon emissions or climate control. Okay. So this graph is 100, sorry, excuse me, seen lots of times. This is typically the way the emissions have gone between 54 and 2004 until up to that point Bob had his data. And it's roughly linear. Okay. So 7 million tons of carbon per year here. Now, if it went at the same rate, business as usual, not increase, not further in development, it would go up to about 14 billion tons of carbon per year by the year 2054 if it went linear at that same speed. And that was considered unacceptable. We don't want that to happen, and so on. So if you want to reduce this, let's say you want to make it flat. Nobody expects to reverse things that quickly, but at least you stop any further emission rate than what you have today. Then this entire region that is sort of shaded in green here, which is what it would have been in terms of carbon emission, the sources of that energy would have to be replaced by something, whatever. And Robert wrote a fat book and so on, saying, all right, let me try to replace, you know, part of this, a slice of this I'll replace by better transmission, better usage, less waste, slice of it by sustainable resources and so forth, and part of it by nuclear. And it's easy to calculate this, and it is showed that storage, solar, wind energy, all those things can be used to get rid of that extra green wedge. Fusion, by the way, is not in, on the table at all, it's just too far away. But to even replace a fifth of that green wedge, so we go back to the green wedge for a second, to replace even a fifth of that, so you just want to go from, just replace this part. That itself will require a lot of nuclear energy. You will need to have a total capacity of 1,000 gigawatts in the world to produce the kind of energy to replace that one-fifth of that wedge. So even if you succeeded in this, by the way, we have only 370 gigawatts today. Oops, excuse me. So 1,000 gigawatts is no joke. In India right now, we have 4.7 gigawatts. So, and the US has 300 or so. So the total world capacity is 370 gigawatts today. Even if you double it, it's not enough. You triple it, you get to about here. Now that is what will get rid of, replace for you one-fifth of the carbon emission that is to be replaced. It's something like that feasible in 45 years, which is the rough plan. In the next 50 years, you want to do that. That's one question. There's a question of how fast can you construct and so forth. Can the world absorb 1,000 gigawatts more? Is there a need for this? There's certainly need for electricity. That doesn't mean they can absorb nuclear electricity of this size. So these questions are all legitimate questions. And finally, is there enough fuel? I mean, reactors run on uranium or things which are called fertile materials like thorium. And is there enough in the world to do this? So these are all valid questions one can ask. The answer to whether there's enough fuel, I don't want to go into details, I've given some of the details here. There is more than enough uranium to have 1,000 gigawatts for several decades. And this table sort of tells you that at the rate of 2004 production of electricity, current technology, you can have 675 years worth of uranium to fuel today's rate of nuclear power. If you want to triple today's, you still have 200 years. And this is without what's called the closed cycle, where you reproduce some of the fuel. We can talk about that later. We are trying to do that in India. Then you have really tens of thousands of years worth of fuel around in the world. So fuel is not the problem for running that many reactors and generating 10,000 gigawatts, 1,000 gigawatts. So that seems okay. And many people, many countries wanted to go nuclear, and here's a picture telling you the trend. This is all a couple of years, this is all pre-Fukushima. And this picture shows you sort of the darker colors are the countries that were already nuclear, India, China, and so forth, Russia, the US. And the lighter colors are the countries that expressed an interest in becoming nuclear a couple of years ago, pre-Fukushima. So all of Northern Africa, several countries in Europe, some in South America, okay. Kazakhstan, Mongolia, and so forth, which expressed interest in turning nuclear. Of course, not every country that wants to go nuclear can go nuclear. Typical requirement on the grid is that any new plant you build, any single new plant, should not have a capacity which is more than 10% of the grid. Because something should happen to the whole grid will start tumbling, like happened here when something was turned off and all of us lost electricity in Delhi. So there is a requirement that no single generator of electricity, this is an informal in the trade understanding, should be more than 10% of the grid. Now when you look at the countries of the world, this is the red line here is what 1000 megawatts or 1 gigawatt line indicates. The vertical lines are the grid sizes of various countries. And you can see the whole bunch of these wannabe nuclear powers simply can't handle it. Their grid size is too little. And you can, of course, ask that you take on reactors which are less than 1,000 megawatts. But all the big companies that are making reactors these days are all 1,000 megawatt reactors. There's the Americans, the French, the Russians. The only ones making less than that are the Indians. We are actually making 220 megawatt reactors, the so-called CANDUs, Those reactors, in fact, I've been suggesting to these chaps, why don't you sell it to the countries? Because they are small enough, some of these countries can handle them. But generally speaking, the 1000 megawatt reactors, which are the typical size of reactors, cannot be handled by many countries that want to go nuclear, but that still leaves many which can handle it. So it was expected that there would be nuclear expansion and revival in all these countries up to what here. In fact, UAE, you know, has just bought four or three reactors from the Koreans. So this is the situation, and it was expected that at least there will be expansion in these countries. But then came Fukushima. So the scene up to here, this enthusiasm was pre-Fukushima, then post-Fukushima. That had a massive impact on public perceptions of nuclear energy. Much, much more massive than Chernobyl, which was a far more serious thing than Fukushima is, by order of probably 10. But nevertheless, the Fukushima reactor explosion really captured the public view, and there were many good reasons for it. As you know, the media had everything to do with it, because there was an earthquake and a tsunami right there the day before. So the world's media had assembled there to cover this earthquake and tsunami. And then somebody told this guy, hey, there are 5 reactors there, and all the cameras turned towards those reactors, and sure enough, one of them exploded. Tsunami was forgotten, the earthquake was forgotten, everybody was looking at reactors. So, you know, from their point of view, it was a bit unfortunate. So public perceptions were severely affected by this, and the nuclear industry, which was hoping to enjoy a revival, instead found itself being facing charges of being unsafe and expensive. And anti-nuclear activists around the world felt re-empowered by what happened in Fukushima and demanded the closure of all reactors everywhere in their respective countries. As we know, there was something like that here, and different countries responded differently, of course, which is a long story into itself, its politics and so on. I won't go into that here. As you know, Germany decided to phase out its entire nuclear program within a decade. Now, insiders of German politics know why this happened and so on. One of their ministers was standing for elections the next day. They had to do it before the votes were cast, they did it. Other countries like the US, UK, Russia, China and India conducted safety reviews to the extent they saw fit. You and I may or may not agree how much, whether what they did was enough, but they did what they thought was fit and decided to continue with their nuclear energy, but at a more cautious pace than before. Those developed nations that had chosen not to go for nuclear, New Zealand, Norway, Italy, had a smug look saying, see, we told you we should not do this. So they were quite happy when that happened. There's no change for them. And as to those developing nations that caught up in the euphoria, that's the most interesting part. Many non-nuclear countries wanted to go nuclear. What they will do post-Fukushima remains to be seen. Okay. It's just been a few years. It's less than 3 years ago that it happened. So, meanwhile, as I said, UAE has gone ahead with its plans to have 4 reactors in a deal with South Korea. This is the first time South Koreans are selling reactors around the world. So, what the rest of the countries will do, we don't know. What will happen to the revival? How much? We don't know. The American revival is definitely back on. They're just going to be more careful, but they're still going to license all those reactors. Now, this is sort of the situation around the world now. Now, let me go on to India. Indian program, as I said, began in the late 40s, has been enjoying steady support from the government. Our program is entirely governmental from beginning to end, including the personnel, everything is government. It has grown slowly but steadily all the time. And there has been no weakening of support, world trends and all never bothered our people, it just went at a certain rate. But in more than 6 decades, they have only been able to develop a very small amount, less than 5 gigawatts of electricity, capacity. And 2 more will come if Kodungallam comes into action. So that will make it 5 plus 2, 7. This has to be compared to the 100 in the US and things like that, or 30 in the UK or 30 in France. So why was the Indian development so slow? This is a political question partly, so I don't want to get involved in the politics of it. But there are certain objective reasons that they can point to, our atomic energy people. One was the unavailability of funds. So it's hard to remember these days, young people don't know, we were once a poor country. If you look around, we are still a poor country, but we think we are not. At that time, we knew we were. So at that time, you could not give too much money to things, fancy things like nuclear energy and so forth. It was more a prestige issue than anything else. So it was supported, but not with sufficient funds if you ask the boys who have to do the work. In fact, I'll show you a chart. You will see that until the economic revival started by Narasimha Rao, only 6 reactors had been commissioned by then. The rest came after the economic revival. Then around 1990, the government opened up the economy, the GDP started growing, and when GDP starts growing, there has to be commensurate growth of electric consumption. This is almost parallel, the two of them, each is proportional to the other. And now we have 20 reactors since the 1990s, compared to only 6 before that. The other important factor behind why the Indian development was so slow was that, as you know, there were sanctions against India after the Pokhran explosion. And India was denied international cooperation, advice, material, technology, expertise, everything, not only on dual-use weapon-related things, but all nuclear-related things, because in principle everything was dual-use. So the Indian nuclear establishment got absolutely no material or support from outside, except what you get under the table, here and there, small things, but basically they were without support. So thanks to the Indo-US deal, now the sanctions are lifted. But until the US deal was completed, which was in 2008 October, these sanctions were on. So that's one of the reasons for the slow expansion. And the final reason for the slow expansion is that you need fuel. And for our reactors, the fuel is uranium. And India's uranium ore is poor quality and small in size. There is a book called the Red Book that the International Atomic Energy Agency publishes, which tells you roughly how much uranium is under the ground in every country. They can be wrong, but they're based on reasonably reliable sources. And in India, they have only 8,400 tons of resources. Some of it is reasonably assured, others are inferred. But even if you take all of the 8,400 tons, you will see it's not very much. Furthermore, we are mining only 300 tons a year. So whatever little mining we are doing, which itself is a controversial matter as to whether it is harming the people around the mines or not, but the mining is very small, it's only 300 tons a year. So they didn't have enough uranium to go faster anyhow. So for all these reasons, they did not go faster. To this you can add other reasons, but those are offensive reasons, like they were inefficient and so forth. That's so true. So the program suffered from uranium shortage as well. These are the reasons. So far what India has done, I'll show you this, how you can see, maybe the that part is not clear. What is here in orange, these are all the reactors we have, all 20 of them listed. The orange ones were the ones that were built after 1990. Okay? There are more of them, all these and all these. The few ones which are in blue were the ones that were there before the economic reform began, and which is much smaller in number, much smaller in capacity. And the two under constructions are the ones that are in the newspapers, Kodungallam 1, which may be online next month, and Kodungallam 2, which is still a year to go. Okay? So this is the situation in terms of how many reactors we are, what their names are, what their types are, when they were started, and what their power is. Typically 220 megawatts. This is what I said, we know how to make these well. These were in turn copied from the Canadian reactors, so these are can-do reactors, but by now we know how to make them. In fact, we have even made one which is bigger, based on the same technology, but bigger. So we are in a good position to actually make and sell these things. But right now, the Indian problem is they can't make enough for their own needs. So there's no question of selling it outside. So this is the situation regarding the current Indian capacity. And this is a different chart. It tells you the various energy sources. And this is 2012, year old. But the general idea remains the same. And just add 10% to everything. So out of the total of about 200 gigawatts of electricity that we have, only 5 is nuclear. Okay. All the other sources are listed here. Coal is, of course, the big one. So if you want to even have 10% of energy capacity, I mean electrical capacity coming from nuclear, you would have to have 20 gigawatts and we only have 5. That is today. If it takes you 10 years to do that, this 200 is going to go to 300 to 350, I'll come to that. So even having 10% of Indian electricity come from nuclear fission is not going to be easy, it's going to be difficult. So there's no question of India suddenly turning all nuclear or all power coming from nuclear. None of that is going to happen. But at the same time, it can give you, if you work hard, a significant chunk, like 10%. Even that is a bit optimistic. And it's just another one, it's an old table from Planning Commission. There is no newer table than this. But there are newer numbers, but the idea is not significantly affected by the newer numbers. You can see that by the year 2020, what is 200 today in terms of total capacity will become 300. And the Planning Commission's plan was that we would have 26 gigawatts by then. Right now, we don't even have 6. We have 5. So it's a long way to go. 5 in 60 years, 20 more in 9 years, can you do it? It's a big ask. Okay? And by 2030, it's more ambitious. The country will need 550. And this can be up and down. By the way, this is all done with an 8% growth rate, 8 to 9. Since the growth rate has come down, hopefully these numbers will also come down. So the task is less difficult than you thought. But still, that's not a happy way for it to resolve itself. So the 500 may not be 500, but it's of that order. And if you want 10% of that, I mean, the Planning Commission picked the number 57. That, as you can see, huge compared to this 5 or 6 that we have till today. But this is the plan, that there is going to be a nuclear energy expansion. It wasn't a totally crazy plan, in the sense that after the Indo-US deal came, and at that time we knew it was coming, we knew how it was going, it would have been possible with the help of a lot of reactor companies from many countries, you know, Russia, America, France and so on, each of them building reactors for us, whole bunch of them, you might have been able to reach something like this, may not be this. Okay? So that was the idea. So this is the situation, this is another graph showing you the same thing, at the rate at which, this is in terms of consumption of electricity rather than capacity of the reactors. This is the rate at 8%, this is the rate at 9%, it roughly becomes 5 times what it is today. And if it's 5%, you can see it may be somewhat lower, but still a big amount has to be generated by nuclear energy. Now, the government has gone ahead at various times, the government being multi-headed, everybody announces a different number. So over the last 3 years since the Indo-US deal, all kinds of numbers have come out, okay? Including from the various heads of the country, so to speak. But let us take 25 to be sort of the most realistic, modest of all the claims that the government says we're going to achieve, and 55 by 2030, is this at all feasible? Or is this totally a pipe dream? Without the Indo-US deal, there is no way this could have been done. We can't even run the existing reactor, we don't have uranium. And without the nuclear suppliers group, which is the group of countries around the world that decide whom to give nuclear materials to, who not, who finally permitted India to become nuclear, thanks to a lot of help from the US. If this had not happened, there is no way we could have achieved all that. But it happened, that's part of the past. So at least that obstruction is removed. India also doesn't have enough uranium, this is a really repeat partly of the earlier slide. These 84,000 tons of assured reserves at this kind of capacity will last for very few years. In fact, less than 2 decades, it will be finished. All the uranium under the ground, even if you could pump it up. Having uranium under the ground is one thing, having it in my hand is another. But even if you could get it all out in 25 years, it will run out. So clearly, you couldn't have done it without the deal. But what the deal does for you is that you can now import uranium, which you couldn't do before. Countries were not allowed to sell you uranium. Now they are allowed. As you know, Kazakhstan sold a lot, and Niger has sold us a lot, and Australia is talking about it. They have had a change of government recently, so the new government is more inclined to give us the uranium. And the uranium is going to be available from somewhere or the other. We are already stocking up on it. So that problem is also removed. So some of this is feasible. And finally, as I said, the most important thing apart from getting uranium and technology is that other country reactor companies can simply come and build the reactors here. So if the capacity of your total manpower in the nuclear business in DAE is not enough to build more than 1 or 2 reactors a year, these guys can come together, they can start building reactors. So that is the plan. A Russian reactor park, a French reactor park, an American reactor park, even all these parks really develop and, you know, begin to shoot up reactors, then it's possible that you can do better than at least what you've been doing so far. So what has happened after the nuclear deal? I mean, the nuclear deal makes it feasible. Agreement to buy uranium from Kazakhstan, Namibia, Mongolia, Niger and Canada have already been done. Things have been signed and some uranium has already come. Australia, as I said, is a question mark. At the time I made the slide, it's still true. Sanction against transfer of technology were lifted, although there are one or two items against on which there are still strictures. As a sort of technical detail, the government is unhappy about it, but barring one or two such items, technology for reactor purposes is available. And India is initiating agreements for construction of reactors, as I said, by these three countries, all of which have been waiting for the Indo-US deal to come so that they could be allowed to build reactors. Now, there was no requirement in the Indo-US deal. You can go and read it line by line, word by word, as I've done. There's nothing there at all at any stage that India should buy US reactors. Okay. It was expected that US being one of the big reactor makers, India will buy, but there's nothing in the deal. The deal doesn't collapse if you don't buy US reactors. But long before India, France was there, you know, straining at the gates, wanting to build a reactor, and as were the Russians, who were already building some for us. The Kudankulam reactors were started before the Indo-US deal. Okay. So there were some cynics in India, particularly from the institution I work in, who thought the whole purpose of the US deal was the reactor sales. That doesn't make much sense. Reactors are a pittance, $10 billion. What's involved here is much bigger. Military cooperation, keeping China at bay, this and that. So the reactor sales were not the big issue. Although, of course, a reactor sale is a reactor sale. That company will be very happy. Westinghouse, GE, and so forth. That was not the real motivation. This is just an aside. So it was the geopolitical strategic value of increasing cooperation with India that was behind the deal. And India was not obligated, therefore, to buy a whole bunch of reactors from Americans. So that's why they're able to buy it from whoever is making it first. The Russians have already been doing it, so they'll, in fact, be getting ahead of everybody else. So as I said, India was an attractive thing for the US, next door to China, and at least at that time, enjoying rapid economic growth and considered as a potential power. All these words have to be now, you have to say it more cautiously. So apart from the US, France and Russia too are very much in the market, and it was known from the beginning that France and Russia will enter, and they clearly said, we want to build, but we don't want to push the case through the nuclear supplies. We want the Americans to push the case. It was widely understood by everybody. So the Americans pushed the case in their own country for their country to be allowed to interact, and with the nuclear suppliers group so that other countries can interact. This is all done. So I think this was an act of statesmanship by this poor man, on whom people are always throwing eggs for other reasons. But in fact, for India, he was a friend. It can happen. Many of our friends have been not necessarily good guys. Half the roads in Delhi are named after tyrants and dictators and so on. So it was understood, of course, that US firms will also build reactors in India. And sure enough, they are going to do it. But the Russians and French were right off the block. They were ready. They were much more prepared to do so. And even before the deal was completed, they were all setting up offices here. Arriva had people sent here. Russians were proceeded much further because they were already building some reactors. You can ask, how come the Russians could build these reactors when there was international sanctions against India at the time when they started building it? That's because there are always lawyers. You can always find, I hope no offense to anybody who's a lawyer here, they can always find a reason. It's called grandfathering. You know, there are ways you say, well, this was not really valid at the time when the thing was signed. Well, it wasn't signed when it was thought of, or when the person who thought of was still, you know, being thought of by their parents, and so on. I mean, so there are rules and ways by which you can legitimize things up to a point. And the US at that time was willing to let it go. Chalo, do reactor banane do. The Russians were, therefore, without any serious international opposition, allowed to start these two reactors in Kudankulam, you know, which are the controversial ones. So Russians have already been building two reactors for us. As I said, this is the grandfathering business. It's a phrase in the trade. In fact, the Chinese are trying to say that the reactors they are building for Pakistan, they're building two reactors, are also similarly valid because they also are grandfathered. And of course, it's not allowed at all according to NPT, and they're not supposed to do this. But this is how international treaties work, and this is how international politics works. Once again, people say, chalo, Indians have got the Indo-US deal, let them have two reactors from China. So much of the legal situation is always tempered in international politics by realism. So other countries look the other way. When Russia did it in India, they're looking the other way. When China is doing it in Pakistan. In addition to the Kudankulam reactors, the Russians were offered as part of the new revival, a whole reactor park where they will build many more reactors. 8,000 megawatt reactors was the plan. in a place called Haripur in West Bengal. As you know, there were major protests in Haripur, and Didi said no way, and so now it looks like that will have to be moved somewhere else. Russians are very unhappy. I mean, they say, what is all this protest? We don't have them in our country. So that's the difference, you know. So the negotiations are going on, where else can you locate it and so forth. Huh? And so that site, as well as the Russian site, as well as the sites offered to the French and Americans, may have to be shifted. Jetapur, which is the French site, again there are protests there. There are also some genuine concerns because the reactor, the earthquake activity in Jetapur may be higher than what they thought. Better data now. So they may have to shift that. But these are shifts of locale. There will always be this problem of shifting things. I'll come to that later. The new land acquisition bill is relevant to this, and we'll see what it does. Okay. French reactors. The French were building, they have a huge reactor giant, Areva, and they were given the site Jaitapur in Maharashtra, and they are expected to build six big reactors. This is more than 1,000, 1650 megawatts. These are the pride of France, the European pressurized reactor. They think it's absolutely classy, very safe, very delicate, very sophisticated, and so on. It's also very costly. And so it's costing us a whole bunch of money if we were to take it from them. Cost is still not completely clear because they are building such a reactor in Finland, and that has been going on and on and on and on. Costs have gone up, it's still not complete. The French say that's because the Finnish are finicky. That is true. What do you expect the Finnish to be, if not be finicky? So they apparently want very strong requirements of safety. Now, you know, every safety problem can be solved if you put enough money in it. So safety is never an absolute thing. It's safety versus economy, which is always the problem. So the cost is going up. The Finns are saying, doesn't matter, we want this thing, we want that thing. So, but there's a useful lesson for us here that the French reactor in Finland is still not complete. Cost overruns have doubled. They're still finishing it. But it's near completion. Then US reactors, I've talked about Russian, I've talked about French. US, there are two companies. Neither of them American, actually. Both are owned by the Japanese now. GE is owned by Hitachi, and Westinghouse is owned by, who is it? It is Toshiba, I think. Somebody owns Westinghouse. So they're really Japanese countries, but the building is actually done in the US. The labor is the US, so the Americans are very much interested in that. And memoranda of understanding were signed with them for building reactors of 1350 each, along with Hitachi, and Westinghouse. Similarly, NPCIL entered into agreements for AP1000, which is the brand of the reactors. These are all pressurized water reactors. I can tell people what it is later if you want. So between them, GE and Westinghouse, the American reactor builders, will build a number of their reactors, and the site allocated for them was a place called Mithi Vurdi in Saurashtra, and Kovala in Andhra Pradesh, and protests have already started in Mithi Vurdi, so we don't know how this is going to go. But this is the present situation. The more serious problem involves the Liability Act, and I'll come to that now later. But sites were granted, protests, well, protests are there, but people know that you wait long enough, the protests go away. And everything looked hunky-dory from the point of view of men of the world. And there seemed to be there was no competition between these countries. The government said, all of you come and build all you can, we need everything. So the Americans weren't competing against the French, weren't competing against the Russians. Anyway, they had different brands of reactors, different capacities, different technical features. So they were not in competition with each other, and the country seemed to be in the market for as much as its budget can afford, and as many as, so there was plenty for all three countries, a very, very comfortable situation for all concerned at that time. Then two developments took place. One bad thing, one negative development, which made things less hunky-dory, was the nuclear liability bill, of which you all heard, and I'll talk about that a little. Second one was, of course, Fukushima. All that happened in the last 2 years. So let me talk about the liability bill, go over it quickly. In August 2010, the Indian government approved the civil liability for nuclear damage bill. As it happened, the discussion, all of you were here, as it happened, the discussion of this bill in the parliament coincided with the 25th anniversary of Bhopal. And all the Bhopal activists were actually in Jantar Mantar trying to raise people's consciousness about what happened in Bhopal and how this gentleman got away free, the Union Carbide man. And so it was very much in everybody's consciousness, and then you're trying to build a nuclear liability bill, bring it into the parliament, and nuclear tragedies people are much more scared of than chemical tragedies. So the government really didn't have a chance of a snowball in hell of getting that through the way they wanted it. Opposition was mounting and the mood was wrong, and the government had also used up its IOUs and its energies in getting the Indo-US deal through, which was, as you know, a very difficult thing. Government almost fell. So they didn't just have enough left to push the liability bill of the kind the government would have wanted. The parliament ended up pushing a much tougher liability bill. So that these are the things I said. Coalition government had expended most of its political goodwill, and shadow of Bhopal was very much there. So it capitulated to sentiments in the parliament that it should not once again sell out to US capitalists. That they were selling out to Russian capitalists didn't seem to bother anybody, but US capitalists were bad news. So by letting American companies off the hook with a lenient law like they had done for Bhopal, true enough, Bhopal, they got away with murder. That France and Russia were involved scarcely figured in the debate. But nevertheless, it was a tough liability act. Actually, it was a very good liability bill in many ways. I liked the bill. One of the things, measures in that bill, was that there will be operator liability of $300 million. Operator in this case is the group that runs the reactor, which in India is Indian government. Indian government is the operator. It will have to give $300 million. But the more important part was that claims for compensation by any victim would have to be dispatched within 3 months of application. In Bhopal, you know, it's been 25 years and many people still haven't gotten their money. Here, there will be a special commission set up, and within 3 months, all cases will have to be cleared. Victims do not have to prove things to the satisfaction of the most complex legal things. Basically, if they've been injured, they get the money. So this is part of the law, and the award has to be made within 3 months. This is a huge enterprise. If to make it happen with our Indian banks, I don't know how they'll do it. But this is what the law says. And I think this is a very, very people-friendly law in that sense. But it had an extra clause. That is what everybody is talking about. It's a clause that permits the operator who runs the reactor to sue the supplier who made and built and gave the reactor. Now, ordinarily, we expect this is okay. I mean, these are the statements from the act, which I've written down if anybody wants to read. Clause 17A, B, whereof, thereunto, and so on. It's all there. But it basically says that the operator can sue the supplier. Seems like a reasonable thing. Somebody's, you know, runs a car and the brakes don't work, you can certainly sue Toyota. You know, that's what's been done. So in most other things, we are accustomed to the fact that if the equipment is defective, you can go back to the man who made the equipment and sue them. In reactors, that has not been the case in the past, because reactors were so, you know, the damage could have been so much that reactor companies said, if you're going to make us liable, we're not building any. The profits of, you know, utility companies are there, but they are not such that they can absorb this. Therefore, the US exempted its people. It had its own liability amounts, but they were funded from by the providers, by the operators. So it may sound reasonable that suppliers should be liable, especially if it can be established that the suppliers' oversight or their actions that led to the accident, which seems reasonable, they should pay the penalty. But no other nuclear country includes such a condition. India is therefore violating some international convention. Is it violating? Yes, there is an international convention called in Vienna. It has a name which will come to me. Yeah, Supplementary Compensation Convention, in which suppliers are not subject to being sued unless there is willful negligence and malafide or something like that proved. Okay. India's thing is much stronger. If there is an accident, even if it's not malafide, if there is a defective equipment, you can sue them. So this is the law, and this immediately stopped all commercial agreements with all the countries. They said, come on, we can't, they are the suppliers. The American, of course, companies, the suppliers are private companies. They said, no way. The Russians, everybody thought, okay, but Russians sooner or later came around, said, no way. So all the three sets of negotiations have been stalled because of the supplier bill, or the liability bill. The government then tried to see what it could do. So once again, you bring in guys who can find ways out of things. Then it turns out that every act, there is something called rules where you implement the act, which have to be written down. and you can try to do funny business in the rules. So, in an effort to allay the concerns of the suppliers, the reasonable concerns, nobody else does it in the world, the government notified a set of rules for the operation of the Liability Act. And that mitigated the penalty quite a bit. For instance, the right of recourse shall be for the duration of the initial license, which is only 1 year actually. Or I guess it's 5 years in certain cases, and 1 year, let me see, whatever, product liability periods, which is 1 year. These are all much smaller than the lifetime of the reactor. The original bill might have said that if the reactor is going to be operating for 60 years, and in the 59th year, the poor creaking reactor breaks down, you go back and sue somebody's grandfather, you know, that he built this reactor at that time. So that was clearly not reasonable. So to clarify that that is not the case, they brought in these rules, brought it to the parliament. And then further technicalities of how much the liability amount would be. The liability amount would be only to the extent that the operator spent money. The operator itself didn't give the public more than a certain amount. The operator can't then sue for their profit money from the supplier. So these were things that were brought in. And no operator's claim can under in no case exceed the actual amount of compensation, etc. This is brought into the rules. But of course, the rules have to be passed by Parliament, so we went back to the Parliament before a standing committee. So the appropriate committees of the Parliament, and this was one of the situations the Parliament was not doing anything. So it went into the Parliament, it stayed in the Parliament session was over, nothing was passed. Turns out if that is the case, the Parliament doesn't get around to passing any objections or amendments to these rules, government can go ahead with the rules. So such are the benefits of the Parliament getting stalled. So the government now, in a sense, is free. But there may be constitutional problems, and our constitution lawyers are in the game. They're saying it's legally and constitutionally required that the rules should carry out the intent and purpose of the act, and these rules don't do it. So even if the parliament can't stop it, the courts may stop it. So this thing is still open. Sorry, Sorabji wrote an article in the Hindu explaining this constitutional thing. So the precise legal situation is murky, even today, as of today. Manmohan Singh is going to the US, and it's expected that some kind of thing will be done for the US reactors during that visit, but what manner it will be, I don't know. How legally, what will be its position? But things are murky. When sufficiently murky, there is always a way out. So much money is involved, and money ultimately wins. I mean, it's commerce that determines all morality. So it may well be that they'll find a way will be found to make the sales possible. Then Fukushima, and this is the last thing that I conclude. The Fukushima reactors had a massive impact, and because of the Fukushima reactors, the nuclear renaissance, as I said, is already stopped, and anti-nuclear activists felt empowered. And this is, I think I've already shown this, I don't know why it's coming again. Activists organized in India major protests against the reactors. The one that is widely known is Kudamguram, where the first of the two Russian reactors was ready to be commissioned. This itself is new. Nothing ever a Russian built has ever been protested against in India. It's the first time. Sign of the collapse of Cold War and sign of the power up of Fukushima that this was done. Site allotted to the, as I said, the Russians at Haripur has to be relocated because of opposition of the local party, the and Areva's EPR reactors in Jaitapur has also met with local opposition. In fact, when President Hollande came to Delhi, there were protests against him there for these reactors. So protests are there on all fronts of these new foreign-built reactors. So one problem that India is going to face in nuclear expansion, whether Russian, US, French, doesn't matter, or even indigenously built reactors, build a new Indian reactor, will be public protests from a mixture of environmental concerns, radiation concerns, and most importantly, I think this is the one that really has real substance, is human displacement concerns. So, of course, I personally believe that the real driving force behind not in my backyard kind of protests is not the nuclear hazards. We can discuss this ad nauseum. It's a technical matter. I think they are not significant. But the loss of livelihood of the local people, inadequate compensation, totally brutal treatment by the government agencies, and lack of support for those displaced, these, I believe, are the primary driving forces behind the protests. They are very legitimate grievances and essentially common to all major new projects which require a lot of land, whether they be dams, factories, copper mines. You know. The new Land Acquisition Act is intended to address these problems. Its impact on the reactor sites remains to be seen. They will be required now to go through much more stringent conditions when they buy land from the people, even the Atomic Energy Commission. But my estimate is that nuclear energy protests may slow down nuclear expansion, but their power, poor guys, is never enough to really derail it. Kodangalam is, you know, the protests have died, have not been able to do it. So I think the expansion will continue, notwithstanding the protests. But the liability issues and the reactor costs are the more serious liabilities. And last slide. Worldwide, I believe that the abandonment of significant rollback of nuclear energy would have been a retrograde step, especially for developing countries whose per capita availability of electrical energy is, say, 8th or 10th of what, say, Germany enjoy. Germany can close it down. I think it's sensible for them to close it down. For us, to closing it down is a different matter. So the world needs every source of energy, unless it is terribly, terribly dangerous, which I don't think this is. And one can discuss that. There is danger associated with nuclear. Nobody says there isn't. There are also hazards associated with not having electricity. And we know that in our country, 30% of rural households and 1 lakh villages do not have electricity even today. It depends on what you call electrification. If there is one khamba standing in the middle of the village and there is a bulb there and you say we have electrified the village, that's not counted. I would count 10% of the at least households should have electricity before I say that a village has been electrified. By that count, there is 100,000 villages that don't have electricity. Unlit roads are unsafe too. It's not just nuclear radiation that's unsafe. Unlit roads are unsafe. Unlit homes are unsafe. Women walking on unlit roads. 5 years ago, I couldn't get any traction for that point. Today, I get a lot of traction for that point. Women in villages and so on, walking through stretches with no light there. Isn't that unsafe? I mean, it doesn't matter whether they die or don't die. Children's eyesight, with reading without lamps and bulbs in their homes. There are lots and lots of hospitals. Operation Hora, power goes off. Happens all the time in rural hospitals. You turn on some generator, taga taga taga, uska diesel nahi hai. Man with the key has gone home, sir. And the operation is stopped halfway. I mean, there are things happen like this all the time. So one has to quantify this damn problem. It's a serious problem. How serious is the hazard? How serious are the alternative hazards? Such quantification is rarely done. All this is basically emotional. Somebody is witness to some bad side or one side of the argument. They remember that, they talk about it. The other side then. Quantification of these hazards is also not easy. How do you compare apples with bananas? It's not easy to do that. But that has to be done. So the actual hazards of nuclear power, therefore, have to be balanced in some quantitative meaningful sense against having no power at all in some sectors, or the cost of making alternate power sources. Not only the financial cost, they also have hazards, not that they are free of hazards, but their hazards seem to be less. So you have to do that, and only then you can decide whether. And last thing is that governments and social activists have to be proactive in educating the public, because public by and large talks out of ignorance. Not just the general public, I'm talking about the educated public, because this is a very technical mamla, you know. So they have to educate people, but they could educate people in a responsible and balanced manner. Neither bland assurance that it's all 100% safe, that's not good, nor stoking of hysterical fears is any good. You have to somehow have responsible education. And the public response to Fukushima shows that the public doesn't really trust the authorities. You can see it in many countries. In China, for instance, you know, when the thing broke, the next day in Beijing, iodine pills, there was a run on iodine pills. Now this is China, it's not the US. California mein hota hai. Anything happens anywhere, they rush to the drugstore. But in China, they went to the iodine pills. The Chinese government said, look, you don't have to. The radiation levels are really so much. You don't need to rush to. But the public didn't pay any attention in Beijing. And Beijing ran out of iodine pills. And furthermore, half of Beijing developed stomach problems because of too much iodine. So all these things happen. It's really happened. It's a health hazard if you have too much iodine. And public doesn't listen in China. In other places, the public doesn't listen to authorities anyhow. In India also. My driver asked me, sir, pani ye barish mein aayega? I said, barish mein nahi aayega, wait, don't worry. He thought it would drain radiation on him. I can't blame him. I mean, the kind of stuff he heard on channel, whatever, made him say this. So we have to educate them. It doesn't mean the fear has no basis, not at all. But how much is the fear? You have to compare it with what happens on the shores of Ganga. You know, the cancer incidence rates on the banks of Ganga are 7 times anywhere else. That is because of all the chemical affluents that are put on both sides of that river. You know? So you have to take a hold of all this. If you are a responsible person, if you just want to protest and go home, you can. You can have a little niche there where you protest and you don't want that taken away. But if you are the government, like them or not, they have to make responsible decisions for 1.2 billion people. I don't like the government. I'm glad I'm not them. But they have to do this, you know. So it's not easy. You have to compare bad things with other bad things. But who will give the public the assurance about, say, radiation, when the people most qualified to give that assurance are the ones who are increasingly disbelieved? This is a problem that we face, not only with respect to this, but with respect to BT brinjal, with genetic these things, okay? And cell phones and everything. So nuclear agencies everywhere in the world, not just India, must work to regain public trust which they have lost if nuclear expansion is to proceed speedily, particularly if in a democracy like ours. Thank you.